Hello again, this is Michael Sulock. This video is going to be focusing on section 9.1. Let's look at this from the perspective of you. You are a keen CCD statistics student and you're getting started on your project and you want to know, do students at CCD like Kanye West's music? You go around to CCD students and you ask them, of course, do you like Kanye's music? And the first person tells you yes. And now you ask somebody else. They happen to say no. Since this is your project, you're going to ask 100 students. After some careful analysis, you look to see that you have 76 people that respond yes, and everyone else responded no. This is your data. And furthermore, you realize that there's a number you are actually trying to figure out. And we call that the parameter of interest. And what is that? In this case, it's going to be a proportion because your data is qualitative and you can't take an average of a bunch of yeses. What you really want is the proportion of your population that like Kanye's music. In symbols, it's a big capital P. You want to estimate this thing, and you have some data, and you recognize that your parameter here is referring to over 10,000 people, and actually knowing what this P is, you would have to ask everybody at CCD. You didn't do that. You only asked 100 people. So what you're going to be doing is estimating this population proportion, this capital P, this parameter. You're going to be estimating the proportion of students that like Kanye West's music. So the first thing you do is recognize that the sample proportion estimates the population proportion. So you remember that you asked 100 people total, and 76 of those people said that they did like Kanye's music, which gives you a sample proportion of 76%. So now I'm going to use an analogy here. This population proportion, this parameter of interest, this thing that's hard to know, we're going to think about that as being a fish, and we want to catch this fish. And if we use p hat to estimate p, because p hat is just one single value, it's like throwing a spear at this fish. It's just one number. It's one point. We call p hat a point estimate of P. And if you think about how many spear fishermen you know, it's not a lot, because catching fish with spears is pretty hard to do. Our sample proportion is unlikely to exactly equal the population proportion. 76 out of the 100 people we asked like Kanye, but that is probably not exactly equal to the proportion of everyone at CCD that likes Kanye's music. So in a way, this 76% is likely to be wrong. It's an estimate, but it's not perfect. And in statistics, we like to be correct. If I report 76% as being equal to P, well, that's not exactly true. It's an estimate of P. What I would really like to know is how close is it to P? And when I just report the point estimate, I really have no idea. I say, hey, this is my best scientific approximation, but it doesn't give me any idea about how close P hat is likely to be to the true population proportion. Just giving a point estimate is a pretty basic way to estimate this parameter. We like a technique that answers this question about how close our estimate, our statistic, is likely to be to the parameter. And so instead of throwing out a single point estimate, we're going to do the easier way to catch a fish, which is to use a net. And we call this net a confidence interval. It turns out a confidence interval is much more useful than a point estimate. And so just as a quick reminder, in math, an interval is two numbers one of which is smaller than the other. And what we're going to say is something similar to, we are pretty sure that our parameter is going to be somewhere within our interval. We don't know where, but we're going to say that it's going to be bigger than the smaller number and smaller than the larger number. It's going to be inside of our net. So it turns out that every confidence interval has what we call a level of confidence, which is a number. And this level of confidence basically says how sure we are that we think the true parameter is within our interval. And just to give kind of a silly example, I'm going to give a confidence interval at the 100% level of confidence, which we're going to call 100% confidence interval. And we're still talking about the proportion of students at CCD that like Kanye West's music. So I'm going to give two numbers that I am totally sure with 100% certainty that P is between. And I told you this is silly, but here they are, 0 and 100%. Did I catch the fish? Definitely. Am I wrong? No. But is it useful? Definitely not. It's kind of similar to a situation where, imagine you witnessed a bank robbery and the police are asking you some questions afterwards, and they ask you, how tall was the person who robbed the bank? And you say, I'm totally sure that they were less than 20 feet tall. Are you right? Definitely. Does that help the police? Definitely not. So we would like to have a trade-off between an interval that we're likely to be right, but also an interval that is going to be useful. You can really give whatever you want as your level, and we'll talk about this later. But what's reported most of the time is what we call a 95% confidence interval. And for this interval, it's possible that you're wrong, but it's going to be more narrow, which is going to mean that it is going to be useful. So let's talk about where this 95% confidence interval is going to come from. It's not going to be 0 to 100%. So the way we make these things is we start out with a point that's going to be right in the middle. Remember that we're trying to estimate the population proportion here. And how did we do that? We asked 100 students and we got 76 out of 100, or 0.76 of them, say that they did like Kanye West's music. So we're trying to throw a net out to catch this fish here, to estimate this parameter. And so where would we want to throw our net? Let's throw it at our best guess at what this parameter is. And what's our best guess of that? It's P hat. There's no other number currently I think is more likely to be this true proportion. So I'm going to put my point estimate right in the middle. Let's make a little number line here to represent the width of our interval. So here's our p hat right in the middle. So let's also make a little formula for this. So it starts out with p hat, and then we want to get to that larger number. And what we're going to do is add what we call the margin of error. So that's p hat plus the margin of error. And to get to the smaller number, I'm going to subtract the same quantity. So the way that shows up in our formula is that we get this plus and minus sign, which means we need to do both. We need to add and subtract the margin of error. And when we do that, we get our interval. But where does the margin of error come from? It comes from two quantities, the first of which is a z-score, and the second of which is a measure of variability of our sample proportion. And I'll just give you this one. This might look fairly familiar. It's the square root of p hat times 1 minus p hat divided by the size of our sample. And this z-score is written in your book as a Z with a subscript of this little fish guy, which is alpha. There's a lot of Greek letters in here, and this is another one, alpha over 2. So these two quantities together, when you multiply them, you get the margin of error. So this is our formula for a confidence interval for the population proportion. So the only part that really looks strange here is this z-score. And we said it's a z-score, which means its distribution is the specific type of normal distribution called the standard normal. Z-scores always come from a distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. And how do I find that value? It's really a percentile. And it's a percentile from the standard normal distribution. So for a 95% confidence interval, which is what we're trying to make here, we haven't made it yet. We've got the formula, but we haven't made the interval. The z-score that we use, I'll label it right here. It's the value such that you have 95% between it and negative the value. And because this is symmetrical, the distance these two things are from the middle will be the same. So how would I find this percentile? So if there's 95% in the middle here, that means that there's 5% total on the outsides. 5% on the outsides? Well, this is what's known as alpha. But notice this is alpha over 2. And why is that? Because on each side, there's 5% over 2. There's 2.5%. So if I want to know this number, I could do a couple of things. I could find it directly by finding the 97.5th percentile, or I could just find this number and take the positive value, take the absolute value of the 2.5th percentile. Whatever way you want, let's find the 2.5th percentile of a standard normal distribution. If you remember, we have two different functions we used with the standard normal distribution, and the one called invnorm finds percentiles, and the first number you give it is the area below as a decimal, not as a percentage. If you put 2.5 here, you will get an error message, and then I need to give it the mean and the standard deviation. And if I do, I get negative 1.95 something, which typically gets rounded to negative 1.96. But what we tend to use in the interval is just the positive value. So although inverse norm gives me negative 1.96, it really doesn't matter if I use negative or positive because this formula has the plus minus in it. So what your book reports is positive 1.96. So every single 95% confidence interval for P has this same formula. And furthermore, this Z of alpha over 2 is always 1.96 for a 95% confidence interval. And every time your level of confidence changes, you use a different z-score here. Just to show you really quickly how you might find another one, say instead of a 95% confidence interval, we wanted to find a 80% confidence interval. And all these numbers are going to change. So my drawing isn't going to be quite to scale anymore. Now that means I have 80% in here, which means that my alpha level now is 20%, which means that I have half that on each side, which means that the z-score that I want is the 10th percentile. So I would put 0.1 here, and when I do that, if I round it, this negative number is negative 1.28, but I tend to use the positive value, which is 1.28. So if I was making an 80% confidence interval, an interval that I was less sure that I captured P, I would use a smaller number here, which means that my margin of error is smaller, which means that my confidence interval is narrower, which kind of makes sense because I'm going to be less sure now. So the more sure I want to be, the larger value I end up using for the Z of alpha over 2 value. So let's just go ahead and actually calculate the most frequently used level of confidence. We're back to Kanye, and we're going to find an interval that we are fairly sure that the true proportion of CCD students that like Kanye West's music will be within. We are going to find a 95% confidence interval for P. So all we have to do is be very careful and follow the formula here, follow this set of instructions for creating this net. So I said, if it's a 95% confidence interval, we'll be using 1.96. And then I know that my sample size is 100. I asked 100 people. So those are the numbers that are going to go inside of this formula. So now I'm just going to be careful. Okay, I start with P hat, which is 0.76. It's important to use the decimals here, plus or minus. Now I'm working on the margin of error, which is 1.96 times the square root of P hat again, times 1 minus P hat, divided by the size of my sample. So the next thing I always do is I find the standard error. And calculating this, maybe I'll do that off to the side, just so I don't have to write everything out the whole time. So what? I've got the square root of 0.76 times 1 minus 0.76, which is 0.24. All that is divided by 100. So maybe just because I'm making this video, I'm going to write out every single step. And if you were doing this on your final exam, you'd be more likely to get this problem right. Now I need to take the square root of 0.001824. And I can actually take that to the 1/2 power if I'm being clever. But regardless, I should get, with a little bit of rounding, 0.0427. So that number is going to go in my confidence interval along with my z-score to give me my margin of error. So what am I going to get? My margin of error is 0.0837 with a little bit of rounding. And now I'm finally ready to give my smaller number and my larger number to give this as an interval. So I like to just kind of start out by building the framework here, put the parentheses and the comma. And for whatever reason, I tend to do the plus first. When I add it, I get the bigger number, 0.8437. And when I subtract the margin of error, I get the lower number. And these two numbers together in this format right here is my confidence interval for P. And specifically, it's a 95% confidence interval for the proportion of CCD students that like Kanye West's music. And that is my net. And that's a little more useful than just giving the point estimate itself. The margin of error is basically telling me that my point estimate is likely to be as much as about 8% off in either direction. So another thing that we frequently like to do is to kind of explain this a little bit more, which when we do these interpretations, we're trying to just use normal English to talk about what this means. And the way interpretations for confidence intervals always start, it's by saying we are whatever level confident, which in this case is 95% confident. And just think of this as saying we're pretty sure that, now I want to talk about my parameter, that's the proportion of CCD students that like Kanye West music, and now I'm just going to say it's in this interval. It is between 67.63% and 84.37%. And I could have reported the proportions here, but I tend to report the percentages just because it's more easy for people to understand. So this is a statement that is actually a lot more useful to someone than just saying, oh, my sample proportion was 76%, because that is my spear, that is likely to be wrong. So instead, I make a net, and I'm pretty sure that my net is right. I don't really know where. It could be really close to 67, or it could be really close to 84, or it could be somewhere in the middle. But I feel fairly strongly that it's between these two numbers, which gives me more information. It tells me how accurate my estimation is. So that is covering section 9.1, estimating a population proportion, catching a fish by creating a confidence interval, a net. And just like in life, there's a possibility that we might have missed the fish, but we're pretty sure we didn't. We're pretty sure the proportion is in here. I hope that was helpful, and I will see you next time.